Hey everybody, Mike here. Welcome back to the channel. Guys, in today's video, I'm gonna be showing you how to build your very own photo and video editing PC. So all the parts are here in front of me. I have my PC right here. And today, what I'm gonna be doing is I'm gonna be swapping out some of the parts that are in here with some of the parts that you see right here. This video specifically isn't geared towards a gaming PC. However, this build will work extremely well for gaming if that's something that you wanna do as well. All the parts and all the specs for this system will be down in the description below, so you can check that out if you're interested. But I mostly just wanted to make this as a guide for people that are looking to build a PC in 2019 or even beyond that is really good for photo and video editing. Now real quick guys, I just want to mention that if you're into cameras or photography or filmmaking and you like watching tutorials and learning new things with all of that, or maybe you would like to watch me try new things and go on adventures and take my photography out into the world and show you guys and bring you along with me on those adventures, then guys, make sure you start right now by subscribing to my channel. Click that bell icon as well so you get notifications every time I post a new video. And yeah, let's get started building this photo and video editing PC. Okay, so before we jump into this fully, I do wanna say that there are some things that I will advise you to have on hand before you start building your own PC. The first thing is gonna be a roll of paper towels. They're just handy, all right? You don't know, you know, I'm working on a black desk so I could tear off one of these and put screws on them so that I can see it against a white background. I always recommend as well using zip ties for your cable management. So if your case didn't come with any when you bought your case, make sure that you buy a little pack of zip ties for the cable management stuff in the back. Cable management is extremely important. Obviously, you wanna have as well some screwdrivers. These two are basically the same, but I would recommend you get a couple that are different sizes just in case you have different screw sizes, but you're definitely gonna need a screwdriver. A pair of scissors you're also gonna need as well to cut off the little ends of the zip ties when you're done zipping them. Zipping them tight. I also recommend getting a can of compressed air in case there's any dust in your current system that you want to get out, or just in case you want to make sure everything's completely clean and dust-free when you start. And then the last thing that I use, it's kind of, I think it's kind of nerdy, but it definitely protects your system. And this is an anti-static wristband. So what this does is you clip this onto something metal. I'll show you guys exactly what to do, like best practice situation here. You're gonna wanna use your power supply, but you basically just put this on your wrist. It's got a little metal piece here that is going to make sure you're always connected to metal and you're discharging any static out into a safe area and not into your electronic components, which can, if that happens, it can damage them permanently. So you wanna avoid that. Also, I do wanna mention as well, a really important thing to have on hand is either a computer or a phone, something that can connect to the internet in case you have problems. Obviously, you're building a PC, so your internet accessibility might be a little bit limited, but in case you run into any problems and you need to troubleshoot while you're building, I recommend having either a laptop on hand or a cell phone so that you can connect to the internet and Google search and try and find some fixes to your problems, maybe on forums or whatever. Last but not least, I recommend making sure you have your operating system available somehow. I put mine on a flash drive so that I can boot from the flash drive when we get into the BIOS and then install that onto one of the new hard drives. So I went ahead and prepped this beforehand on this PC. I bought a new copy of Windows. I put it on here through the Windows Media Creation tool. And then I'm gonna be plugging this in on the new rig's motherboard so that we can essentially boot Windows from the flash drive. So those are all the things I kind of recommend before you get started. Yeah, I think it's time to dive into this. Here we go. Nope, forgot one thing. And that is if you are upgrading a current rig to a new rig, I would recommend you take pictures of your rig. In the case that all these parts don't work, and I need to go back to using these parts until I can find parts that do work, I took very high resolution pictures of my build, both front side and the back side, so that if worse comes to worse and I don't know where something goes, I can at least zoom in on those high res pictures and look at what cable was plugged in where or whatever, just in case I forget. And guys, if you're looking to build your own system, I recommend using a website called pcpartpicker.com. Put a link to that in the description below. You can build out your very own list of parts that you want to use for your own system, and it will let you know whether they're compatible or not. So you gotta make sure when you buy a motherboard that your processor is compatible with that motherboard and that your RAM is compatible with the processor and the motherboard.
For this photo and video editing PC build, I've chosen to go with the Intel Core i9-9900KF. This CPU is the exact same one as the 9900K, but does not have a working graphics processor in it, so you'll need a separate graphics card. I also got it on sale from Newegg.com a couple weeks ago, which was a huge win. This processor has a base frequency of 3.6 GHz and a max boost frequency of 5 GHz. It has 8 cores and 16 threads, making the CPU perfect for video editing. Typically, when looking for a CPU for video editing, the more cores the better, though going over 16 cores may be a bit overkill, as I'm not sure programs like Premiere Pro are designed to use more than that yet. Always check online first to see what your software supports. Programs like Adobe Lightroom Classic, however, tend to perform best on CPUs with up to 6 cores, so ensuring that your CPU has at least 6 cores and fairly high clock speeds will increase the performance of Lightroom. I felt that the i9-9900KF fit perfectly for both of these programs and workloads, offering 8 cores with hyper-threading for video editing, but also covering that high gigahertz clock speed that Lightroom benefits from. So, as the heart of this system, the CPU should work extremely well. For the motherboard, I went with the Gigabyte Z390 Aorus Pro Wi-Fi. Not only does this motherboard support my CPU's LGA1151 socket type, but it also has spots for 2 M.2 drives. It has Wi-Fi and Bluetooth 5 built in, which is a feature I wanted so I could connect wirelessly to my Bluetooth soundbar. On the back panel, it has one USB Type-C port that supports USB 3.1 Gen 2, as well as 9 USB Type-A ports, two of which are used for USB 3.1 Gen 2, 3 are used for USB 3.1 Gen 1, and 4 are for USB 2.0. All of these ports with various speed options make it easy and future-proof for plugging in thumb drives, external drives, etc., and dumping photos or videos onto your system fast. For the RAM, I went with 2 sticks of Corsair Vengeance RGB Pro. Each stick is 16GB of DDR4 memory at 2,666MHz for a system total of 32GB. In my opinion, 32GB of RAM is a great amount because for Premiere, Adobe recommends at least 32GB or more if you're editing 4K or higher resolution footage. Now for Lightroom, Adobe says that Lightroom runs best on machines with 12GB of RAM or more, so 32GB gives us plenty of headroom for photo editing, which is great. And because my CPU and motherboard support up to a total of 128GB of RAM, I have the ability to add more in the future if needed. Also, these RAM sticks add some more RGB colors to my case, which I kind of like. Alright, so for my graphics card, I'll be using my NVIDIA GTX 1080 that I already owned. This one comes from EVGA and is called the EVGA GeForce GTX 1080 for the Win 2 edition. While the GTX 1080 came out in 2016 and is one generation behind the current RTX 2000 series GPUs from NVIDIA, it still offers excellent performance for photo and video editing. If your budget allows, or if you want the latest and greatest, then you can definitely go with a newer RTX 2000 series GPU, but this GTX 1080 should still serve me well for a few more years. As a bonus, the GTX 1080 is still new enough that it's getting support for NVIDIA's Studio drivers, which I'll talk more about at the end of the video. Okay, so moving on to storage. For now, I'm just installing 2 drives, but I will be installing more soon. Actually, at the time of filming this, I hadn't decided on the exact setup that I wanted to use yet. The things I did decide on, though, were a 1TB Samsung 970 Pro NVMe M.2 solid-state drive, as well as a 1TB Samsung 860 Evo 2.5-inch SATA SSD. The 970 Pro NVMe drive is what I'll be running Windows from, as well as all of my Adobe programs, and this thing is wicked fast. An NVMe solid-state drive offers speeds far greater than even a regular SATA solid-state drive, so I'm really looking forward to seeing how fast and snappy my machine runs with this installed. For the 860 Evo 2.5-inch solid-state drive, I'll be using this for storage, media cache, and scratch. More on this later. For my CPU cooler, I'm going to be using my Corsair H115i 280mm extreme performance cooler that I already own. I prefer all-in-one liquid cooling units over CPU fans because I find them to be quieter and usually more efficient. Plus, I personally like the water cooling look a lot more than having a big block sticking off your motherboard with a fan attached to it. For thermal paste, I went with the Noctua NT-H1. I read online that this thermal paste does an extremely good job, so I wanted to grab some for this build to try it out. So to power all of this, I chose the Corsair RM850X, which is a white, fully modular PSU that can supply up to 850 watts of power and is rated 80 plus gold. It also has a quiet mode, which means that the fans won't kick on during low and medium loads, allowing my system to remain a bit more quiet, which should be pretty nice. And finally, to house all these parts, I'm using the NZXT S340 Elite case in white, which I already own. It has a lovely tempered glass side panel so you can view the inside of your system and see all the hard work you put into creating it. If any of your components or fans have any LEDs in them, then you'll be able to see those through the glass side panel as well. I've used this case for the past 2 years and have absolutely loved both how it looks as well as the size of it. Okay, so real quick while I'm setting this up, I want to show you guys the little pro tip on how to make sure you're always free of static electricity when you're building a PC. So I just unboxed my new power supply. And obviously this plugs right into the back right here. Because the PC
cable has one of these little grounding plugs that keeps the system grounded or whatever, or it's supposed to. If you plug this in right now and plug this into the wall, do not turn it on. Don't turn it on by pushing this on button here, but you're gonna wanna plug this into the wall, and then when you put your anti-static wristband on, which is gonna keep you grounded, you put this on your wrist, and then you're gonna wanna clip the little metal clip just to one of these, just clip it to the power supply, leave it plugged in but not on, and basically what'll happen is anytime if you do have any static electricity on you, it'll just discharge into the power supply and then it'll just discharge away freely into the, I'm not an electrician, I don't know how that works, but it's safe, okay? If not, you don't have one, you can literally just plug this in, like I said, and just periodically come over and touch it. And that way, if there's any static electricity built up in you, whether you're walking around or, I don't know, hopefully you're not building a PC in the winter with fleece on, because that would be a nightmare. All right, so as you can see, I've got my case totally empty here. I got my old motherboard out. I got all the parts out. We're gonna be starting with the motherboard and installing that first. Okay, so we've got our motherboard here, and right here is our CPU. Now, what we're gonna do first is we're going to open up this box, and we're gonna pull out the motherboard carefully, and this is gonna come in an anti-static plastic bag, so that's pretty awesome. If you're building a PC for the first time, you're gonna definitely want to consult your manual so that you know where everything plugs into. There'll be diagrams in here showing you what each socket on the motherboard is for and how all that stuff works. Okay, so now that you've got everything out of your box, you're gonna close up your box because we're actually gonna be using the box to essentially build on. So the box itself is made of cardboard, therefore it's a non-conductive surface, so it's going to be safe for us to open up this motherboard and place the motherboard here on the cardboard box as we assemble the first parts of the PC. One thing that is important to note is that some motherboards come with the IO shield installed. Mine comes with this installed. Some do not. If you open your box and you see like a little plastic piece this big, make sure that you put that on your case first. If you don't know how to do that, you can look up how to do that online. It's super, super easy. What you don't want to have happen is you don't want to install your motherboard into your case, your computer case, and assemble the whole computer and then realize, oh crap, I forgot my IO shield, because you're gonna have to take everything out to do that. Right here in the middle, this is the CPU socket. Okay, so we're ready to install the CPU. All we're gonna do for this is pull out this little tension arm here. That is going to lift up this little bracket here. And this is going to reveal the socket where the CPU goes. Do not touch this. Okay, if you're installing an Intel CPU, the Intel CPU does not have any pins on the back of it. All the pins are on the motherboard here, so you wanna be very, very careful. The process of installing a CPU is very easy, but you need to just make sure you know what you're doing and be careful because you don't wanna damage anything. The motherboard will pretty much do all the work for you if you install it correctly. So first you're gonna open up the CPU. So what you're gonna look for on the processor itself is this little arrow right here. So you see how all the corners kind of have dots on them? And then this one's got a triangle. That's what you wanna look for, and that's also what you wanna look for on the socket itself, because you're gonna line up the triangle on the processor with the triangle on the socket. So on my motherboard right here, I don't know if you guys can see this, but right there is actually that same triangle. It's just on the motherboard itself. I'm gonna double check with my manual just to make sure. And then you're just gonna wanna line up those two corners. So this corner is gonna go here, and all you do, don't push it at all. You just gently place it. Just let it rest on top of these pins. Okay. So there's two notches up top, and then the corner arrows are right here. So it's literally just the notches lined up, it sort of fell into place. And then all you do is you just push this down, and then you're gonna take this tension arm, and you're gonna push this tension arm all the way back down to where it was when you first started. So this metal piece is going to clip underneath here. And when you do that, this plastic part should pop off. Just like that. Okay, there we go. So now it's on there. I had to apply a little more force than I remember doing the last time I installed a processor.
hopefully everything's okay. We won't know until we start the system up, but you're gonna wanna keep this plastic piece just in case you ever wanna take your processor out of the socket, and you're gonna then wanna put this back on. Okay, so the next thing we're gonna install is the RAM. All right, so I'm gonna be installing it in these two slots here. So we're gonna pull those two clips back. It's gonna be the second one and the fourth one. So that way would be incorrect. So it's gonna have to be this way. And then you're basically just gonna slide it into the channel here. And then just push down on both sides evenly until it clicks in on each side like that. All right, RAM is installed. Okay, so next we're gonna install our Samsung NVMe SSD, which is an M.2 drive, and this is literally the size of a stick of gum. It's very small, and it's gonna go right on the motherboard in this slot right here. You could do it here on this motherboard as well. There's two slots. And then the heatsink just pops off. And on here, there's like a plastic film. So before we put this back on, we're gonna wanna remove this plastic film, because that is going to reveal this really sticky thermal pad that's underneath, and we want that to be sticking to the top of the M.2 drive to keep it cool. Okay, so the first thing I need to do is actually install a standoff screw so that this drive can rest on the screw. Okay, so then what you're gonna do is you're gonna wanna take your M.2 drive, you're gonna wanna line these notches right here with the notches that you see down in here. And you're gonna wanna go in at about a 45 degree angle. And then if you let go and it sort of pops up like this, then you know you did it correctly. Back on. Cool, so now the motherboard is essentially set up for now. All right, so the next thing we're gonna do is we're gonna install the backplate for the liquid cooling unit. Now, if you have a fan that came with your processor or something, if you're just gonna be using a fan unit, then there's gonna be a different process that you're gonna do for this. But I'm using a all-in-one liquid cooling solution from Corsair. So this has a backplate, and then these standoff screws are gonna come out here. So what I need to do first, I'm actually gonna take these standoff screws off first. I left these on here when I disassembled the other motherboard just so that I wouldn't lose them. So you can actually see the four holes up here near the processor. There's like one on each corner. There's one down here. There's one over there. So I'm gonna be putting this plate right here through the back side, but the back plate is now on back here, the back of the motherboard. So then you can lay the board back down. So next we're gonna put these four standoff screws into each of these holes that have now showed up. So now that backplate should be secure, and when it comes time to mounting the all-in-one cooling unit, that'll be ready to go as well. Okay, so now that we have the motherboard all ready to go, it's time to start putting that into the case. Now my case is probably gonna be different than yours, but if you have an ATX size motherboard, which is like the standard size, and you bought a case that fits an ATX sized motherboard, then what you're gonna wanna do is look in your case manual and make sure that the standoff screws are located in the proper spots for the ATX mounting position. If you have a micro ATX or an ITX size board, then you're gonna wanna make sure that the screws are in those proper positions. Now, I'm actually gonna do this on my own. I'm gonna lay the case down and do this. It's just easier for me to do, but essentially what we're gonna be doing is putting the motherboard in here, and then we're gonna be screwing the motherboard down with the screws. And you wanna make sure that this standoff middle screw here comes through the middle of the motherboard where that little spot is. There you will see a spot on your motherboard. Every motherboard has little spots on them that show you where the screws go. It's really not too hard to mess up, but you just kinda line those up with each one of these holes, screw the screws in that have screw holes, and this one does not. So in a minute, I will show you guys what that looks like. So here we go. Now the motherboard is installed, and we're gonna move on to the next thing. All right, so the next thing I'm gonna do is install the power supply down here, and I'm gonna run some of those cables through. I'm gonna connect some of the power cables to the motherboard, as well as connect some of the front panel connectors from the case to the front panel connectors on the motherboard, and kind of just start to get the wires set up and looking clean. Okay, so we've got the power supply installed, and we've got all the front panel connectors that are now plugged in. We've got the motherboard power over here. We've got a USB 3.0 header for the front panel, and we've got the CPU power plugged in up here. So next thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go ahead and install the radiator on the front with the front fans. I'm gonna start routing the fan cables through the back,
and then pulling those also through to the fan controller that's behind my case. That's a separate unit thing that I have. Then I'm gonna start routing all the fan cables to the separate fan headers that are on the motherboard, starting with fan one. I think there's only four fans, so we'll use fan headers 1 through 4. Then after that, I'm gonna apply the thermal paste to the CPU. We'll attach the heat sink and I'll show you guys how to do that. Okay, so I've got all the fans installed, and next thing we're gonna do is we're gonna be taking our thermal compound. So what we need to do is just apply a small dot right in the middle here. That's what the instructions of this says, was to apply a small dot. I've heard online people say apply enough so that it's like the size of a grain of uncooked rice. If you have a bigger processor, then you need to put a little bit more on, but you definitely do not wanna put a lot of this on. You really only need a small amount. All right guys, so this build is starting to come together. You can see everything is starting to look pretty good inside here. What I'm basically just doing now is behind the case, it looks like a total mess. Well, I've got the power supply kind of hanging out here because I'm hooking up cables, making sure everything is powered and plugged in, trying to use the little routers on the back of this case to keep everything somewhat organized. Once I know it's working, once we've got everything ready to go, then I'll come back and do some serious cable management. Okay, so we're gonna install the graphics card now, and I already know where this is gonna go, but if you don't know where a graphics card goes, usually it goes on the top PCIe slot on your motherboard. You're gonna also wanna make sure that you take off the brackets in the back. There's brackets in the back of your case. You're gonna wanna make sure to take those off as well. So let's go ahead and install this. Okay, so you're just gonna wanna push it down until you feel it go in. And once you've lined up the PCIe ports there, and then you're gonna wanna screw it in on the back over here. All right guys, so I think I've got everything plugged in. We've got the graphics card plugged in now, and that's connected to the power supply, and everything else seems to be connected. All the cables in the back are hooked up to something. You don't wanna have anything that's just like not hooked up to something, because then you probably miss something. What I'm gonna do now is hook up my monitor, and I'm gonna plug the computer into the wall, and we're gonna boot it up. Now, if you're building a computer for the first time and you're doing this and you see the motherboard BIOS come on the screen, then congratulations, you did it. You got everything correct. If not, you might have to start troubleshooting, but we're gonna find out and see what happens with this build. So here we go. Okay, so with the keyboard and the monitor plugged in, I'm actually gonna go ahead and I'm gonna plug in the USB now. I'm gonna plug this directly into the motherboard, just in the back and one of the USB 3.0 ports. This, remember, has Windows on it. So if I do get the OS, or if I do get the BIOS to boot, I might as well just install the OS directly to the NVMe SSD that we installed earlier. So I'm gonna plug this in now, and then we're gonna boot it up and see what happens. Fingers crossed, this is always like the most exciting part. All right, here we go. Woo, we got fans spinning. Oh, shoot. Oh, it just rebooted, okay. Yes, we got the BIOS, yes. Okay, let's go to BIOS setup. Perfect, we did it. We had the RAM is lit up, the fans are spinning. This looks pretty, this looks awesome. Let's see if we can get into the BIOS and figure out what's going on. Here we go. Okay, M.2, it's recognizing our Samsung SSD. Awesome. And now it's asking us over here for the boot sequence, SanDisk partition one. That's what we definitely want to do. Everything is running, which is a really good sign. Let's go ahead and boot off of the flash drive here. Let's see if we can get to Windows. It's loading. It's a good sign. Yes. We've got Windows, baby. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and install this and get this set up, and I'll show you guys what this all looks like when it's all done.
So once you get Windows installed, you'll want to head over to NVIDIA's website to download the NVIDIA GeForce Experience program. This will help keep your graphics card drivers up to date. And since this build is geared towards photo and video editing rather than gaming, I recommend you download the Studio driver rather than the Game Ready driver, which according to the NVIDIA website, it says the Studio drivers provide artists, creators, and 3D developers the best performance and reliability when working with creative applications. To achieve the highest level of reliability, Studio drivers undergo extensive testing against multi-app creator workflows and multiple revisions of the top creative applications from Adobe to Autodesk and beyond. This seems to be a rather new thing from NVIDIA, so if you run into any issues with this driver, you can just install the Game Ready driver and that should work just fine. As far as I know, the Studio Ready driver is still fine for gaming, so if you're somebody like me who likes to play video games in your spare time, then you should still be fine with the Studio driver. As for setting up your storage drive configurations, for maximum performance, I recommend installing your operating system and your Adobe programs on your fastest solid-state drive. Then for Premiere, I recommend using your second SSD as a drive for project files, so that would be your video clips, images, etc., basically anything that is going to be in your video. And if you have a third SSD, I recommend using that for your Adobe Media Cache as well as your Scratch disk. If you don't have a third SSD and you only have two, then just put your media cache and your Scratch disk on the second SSD with your project files, but just remember to delete your media cache from time to time as that can eat up some space over time. This configuration should help maximize performance in Adobe Premiere. As for Lightroom, I haven't done extensive testing or research on a proper storage configuration yet, but as with anything computer related, the faster your drive is, the better performance you should get in theory. Because my build is so new and I haven't had time to test things out yet, I may release a separate video later on how to speed up Lightroom, so be sure to subscribe for that. All right, so it works. I'm in Windows now, which I'm super excited about. I absolutely love when you boot up a computer for the first time and everything just seems to work. It's such a great feeling. So I've still got a lot of setup left to do. Obviously I need to set up Windows and get my computer back to the way that I want it to be, get all the programs on there that I need, like the Adobe Creative Cloud Suite, you know, Premiere Pro, Lightroom, Photoshop, all those things. But I hope that you guys enjoyed this video. I do need to do a couple extra things like installing another solid state drive. But anyways, this video's intention was to show you guys obviously how to build a PC. I hope that you guys learned something in this video. If you did, please be sure to hit that thumbs up button. If you have any questions, if you're a photographer or a filmmaker and you have any questions about building your own computer or you have any questions specifically about my build and maybe why I did certain things the way that I did, leave me a comment down below and I'll try and respond to those. You can also hit me up on Twitter or Instagram. So both the links to my Twitter and my Instagram are down below as well. Guys, thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video. Make sure you subscribe and hit that bell if you enjoyed it. And yeah, I'll see you guys in the next video. Peace.